my friends from originally from Indonesia, but they are in here in Tallahassee. Welcome Andy, Daisy, and Dina. And I've been trying to get them for weeks, and one way or another, there's, you know, there's always something. So they're finally able to come this week. So I'm really glad about it. So.
Amen.
Jesus in my heart. I have the love of Jesus down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart. I have the love of Jesus down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart.
Yes, I do.
And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. I have the peace that passes understanding down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart. I have the peace that passes understanding down in my heart. Hard to say, and I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart, and I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart, and I'm so happy,
yes,
so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. The love of Jesus in my heart.
Let's hear it for our kids. Wow, they really did a good job today. Parents, please go sign your children in for kids class at this time. What a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing. You know what I really love about songs like that? And they're kind of ironic because we sing we're so happy, but we look like this. I'm so happy, I'm very happy. Come on, be happy, smile a little. God is good, right?
All the time.
Y'all are still asleep. God is good?
All the time.
All right, I want everybody to stand up just for a minute while we're waiting on the parents to come back in. Let's turn those house lights on just for a second. Uh-oh. Get a little bit of music playing in the background. I want you to walk around, introduce yourself to somebody that you do not know, find out their name, what they do for a living, and become their friends. right, don't bother sitting down, because we're going to go right into praise and worship. Because we've got a good God and we want to worship Him. As you can, go ahead and make your way back to your area.
In Jesus, and the death is beaten, and we are saved. It's a happy day.
The greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive.
Come on, y'all, Jesus is alive.
The empty cross, the empty. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive.
He's alive!
Come on, He's alive!
He's alive! And oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day.
Happy faces.
Forever I am changed. When I stand in that place,
yes, Lord.
Free at last, meeting face to face. I am yours, Jesus, you are mine.
Yes, Lord.
Come on, we belong to Him.
Endless joy, perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease.
It says celebrate.
Jesus is alive.
Come on, He's alive.
He's alive.
Let's see those smiles. It's a happy day.
Forever I am changed. Oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious way. That you. I'll never be the same.
way. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. You came to the rescue. And we welcome Michelle.
Thanks
for the song.
Freedom is a song I sing. I can't contain the joy you bring. All because of your great love. Now I live.
Come on, just sing along. I know there's a new song.
I was dead, but now I breathe. Awaken to your grace so free. In the power of your cross. My freedom, you gave.
Jesus that we can call on his name, and you know that he comes, he will come to our rescue. Whatever your need this morning, whatever your struggle this morning, just come to him. Come to him, and he is your rescue. And his timing is better than our timing. And thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for who you are, Lord. That you are the great I am. And you are our holy God. And thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus.
I wanna be close to your side. So heaven is real, death is a lie. I wanna hear voices of angels above, singing as one.
Come on, sing it, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Holy, holy God Almighty, great I am. Wanna be near to your heart, loving the world, hating the dark. I wanna see dry bones living again, singing as one. Hallelujah.
Come on, hallelujah.
Holy, holy, holy God Almighty,
you are
the great I am, who is worthy, not beside thee, God Almighty, the great I am.
Yes, Jesus, you are the great I am, Lord. Because you are holy, because you are worthy of our praise, Jesus.
The mountains shake before him, the demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell or any. Shake before him, the demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell or any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great.
need you. Do something in my heart to break me apart. I need you.
Yes, Jesus, we need you.
To open my eyes to see that you're shaping my
I forgot to mention a couple things. One of them I always forget to mention. I'm going to get in trouble if I keep forgetting it. You have a connection card that was given to you when you came in. We want to know who you are. We want to be able to contact you, let you know about special events that are coming up.
and also about the things that are happening within the church. There's also on the back, I can tell you more about joining the church, about finding small groups or growth track. Fill these out. Let us know. We also have prayer requests on the front that you can put on there. If you want it private, it'll stay just with me. If you want us to send it to our prayer teams, we'll send it to our prayer teams. You can put those in the offering boxes in the back on your way out, or turn them into any serve team members. So those are available to you. We're excited about that. And we're supposed to have a discovery class today. How many plan on staying for the discovery class today? We've got plans to 10, 1, 2, 2, 3, 4. Okay, all right. Ed, did you catch that? Ed, are you out there? He's out there somewhere. Yeah, we got about 12 planning on attending, okay? Thank you. All right, so we have about 12. Things. Hey, we're starting a new series. Y'all like new series? Amen? Yeah, that was real exciting to me as a pastor.
Woo!
Thank you, brother. We're starting a new series. How about if I tell you what it is? On emotional health. Amen? Yeah, there you go. It is a seven-part series, So we're going to be in this for the next 7 weeks. It's going to be fun, isn't it? On emotional health. Yeah, everybody's like, wow, they're really messed up around here. They need 7 weeks to talk about emotional health. Yeah, I'll give you just a prelude to the different titles. We have God of Hope, which is today. We have Anger Danger is the title of the next week's message. Also, the next one would be Rest after that. Then Disappointments and Failures. Been there, done that. And reprogramming. So to kind of tell you where we're at on that journey, it's going to be good. It's going to be a lot of fun. Make plans to be here. If it speaks to your heart, you can always share these messages with your friends and family members by picking up a DVD or a CD of the service, or downloading the sermon.net app on your phone, iPod, Android device, or anything else, and watching it via there or the computer as well. So I recently heard a story about a gentleman. He was a multimillionaire. The name of the story is I Had Something to Look Forward To. And so this multimillionaire was a businessman, and he had he greatly changed the lives of an entire sixth grade class. He was called on to speak to the sixth grade class in a very poor and destitute area. And they had about a 90% dropout rate in this area. And he knew the importance of school. And so he prepared this long message, this inspirational message, to go and speak to the sixth grade class to inspire them to stay in school and to work hard and to allow God to do something in their lives. And as he's preparing his speech and he's getting ready, he gets up to that day and he gets behind the podium to speak to this sixth grade class, I think 60 sixth grade class members were at this meeting, and he's standing behind the podium, and he takes his notes, and he pulls them out, and he looks at them. He says, I can't share any of this with you. He said, I prepared a speech to inspire you to stay in school. He said, but I just want to tell you what God's done in my life. And he proceeded to how God had blessed him and how getting his high school diploma, he was able to go on and get his college degree, and God had used him to be successful in business. And then he says, what you need more than an inspirational message is a message of hope. So he said to all of those 60 sixth grade students, if you graduate high school, I'll pay for you to go to college. He changed the lives of all 60 of those sixth grade students. Friends, I'm telling you, now they said that they had hope. They had hope for a future, and 90% of them went on to graduate high school and go on to college because this man inspired hope into their lives. They were in a region, in an area, and growing up with no hope, and he came forward and he spoke hope into their lives, and they had a reason to exist. One of the students goes on to say, he said, I have, that day, that message gave me a golden feeling, a golden feeling of hope. And friends, that's what I pray to share with you today, is a golden feeling of hope. We have a God of hope, amen? See, I stand before you as one that met this God of hope. I stand before you as one that has experienced what it is to be so far down, so far out, that you don't even know where you're going to turn to for anything. I've been there where I don't know how I'm going to pay the light bill. I've been there when I didn't know what I was going to do with some crazy kids and not have any clue. I've been there. And God spoke hope into my life. And it changed everything. And today I want to tell you, we've got a God of hope. We've got a God of hope. Turn with me in your Bibles to Romans chapter 15, verse 4. I'm going to share with you some scripture today about hope. It says, for everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and the encouragement of scriptures, we might have hope. Friends, I want to tell you something. Hope is here. Hope is here. When you're feeling hopeless and you're feeling like you don't know which way to turn, if you'll pick up this word and you'll begin to read it, you'll find hope. You'll find encouragement. Hope is here in the Word of God. In fact, this scripture says, for everything that was written in the past was written to teach us. Everything that was written was written to teach us, so that through endurance and the encouragement of scripture, we might have hope. Everything was written. Just mull on that just for a minute. God bless you. Have you ever read your Bible? Have you read about those that were in hopeless situations that found hope in God? Have you read when God has come through in the midst of no hope whatsoever, He's broke through and made a way? Amen. That was written for you. God's word was written for you to read, to take encouragement from, to take understanding from, and understand what God has done in the past, He can do in you. Everything was written. In fact, I want to share something with you today, and please don't be mad at me. Please, I love you. I only say these things because I love you. If I didn't love you, I'd let you go on living your life the way you're living it and wouldn't care. But because I love you, I'm going to say this. If you're in a hopeless situation right now, the only reason why you don't have hope is you're not putting enough faith in God. Amen. The Bible says if you'll read it, you'll have hope. The Bible says if it says right here, it says everything was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and encouragement of Scripture, we might have hope. That means if you're applying the Word of God, if you're reading the Word of God, if you're studying the Word of God, then you'll have hope. Can I tell you what? Some of the things I have hoped that wouldn't happen to me anyways. And it was the best things that ever happened to me once I got through the other side. Friends, I want to tell you something. Some of the stuff that you're holding on to and you're praying to keep, God don't want you to have. I'm just telling you. Imagine if He had answered every prayer you prayed. Especially back in high school when you were praying for a date with the cheerleader. Whew. Thank God you didn't answer that prayer. I looked her up on Facebook the other day. Whew. Leave that one alone. Yeah, y'all never know what I'm going to say, do you? Romans 15 and 13, let's go back to the Word of God where we can find some endurance and strength, right? Romans 15 and 13 says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Friends, we all agree we have a God of hope. We all agree that if you'll read the Word of God, it was written for us to encourage us and strengthen us. And that if we'll apply it and put it into practice, that we'll have hope. And then it goes on to say, may the God of hope fill you with joy and peace. Can I share something with you about joy and peace? Something you really got to understand here, because we get that confused with happiness. Okay, joy and peace are not happiness. Happiness is temporary. Okay, I can be happy because something good happens. Instantly, I can be sad because something bad happens. Now, joy and peace are totally different than happiness. Joy is not dependent, and neither is peace dependent upon the circumstances of life. In fact, you can be totally unhappy about a situation and still be at peace to know that God is God and He is in control. And because you have peace, you'll find that you have joy. And then people are looking at you going, aren't you going through some crazy stuff? But you still got a smile on your face. What's wrong with you? And you get to tell them, Jesus is wrong with me. Yeah, wrong with you or right with you, one way or the other. Amen. Joy and peace. And it comes, as the scripture says right here, come on, let's don't take it out of context. The God of hope will fill you with all joy and peace as you do what? Trust Him. I mean, those are some big words, aren't they? We have trust issues, don't we? Amen. Yeah, we do. I tell you what, we are a people full of trust issues. We have put our trust in people, they have let us down, and therefore we equate God to letting us down too. God won't let you down. God is not going to let you down. The problem is that we think things are supposed to go a certain way, and when they don't, we feel let down. But when we start praying and reading and studying our scripture and looking to God for the answers, you'll find out that those very things that you're going through were blessings from God to get you where you need to go. It's kind of like this. Sometimes the rug has got to be snatched out from underneath your feet to get you to move. Otherwise, you'll just keep standing right where you're standing. Sometimes that's not what God wants. It says, so may the God of hope fill you with joy and peace as you trust Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. You ever met those bubbly people? Yeah, most of the time they just make you sick, right? You're like, can't you just whine a little bit? You know, that way I feel better about my whining and complaining. You know, those joyful people, they just overflow. Man, they got it right. They've got it right. They are in the presence of the Holy Spirit. They are trusting God with their lives, with their resources, with all that they are. Their very self, they're trusting God. See, we need to overflow with hope. Friends, we need to ask the Holy Spirit to fill us. Fill us with hope. And how do we do it? By trusting God. We got to practice what we preach. We can't just keep talking about it and not doing it. We actually got to apply it. We got to practice what we preach. We got to start trusting God. Hebrews 11, 1. Now, all y'all know this scripture. Now, faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Now, I like this scripture because it says, you know, we always talk about faith, you know, the faith chapter, Hebrews 11. And we talk about faith being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Some scripture uses, some translation says faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. And that particular translation, I think it's KJV, I may be wrong, but that particular translation I love because I love that word substance. I love that word substance because faith is the substance of things hoped for. Y'all awake? Good. This is substance. I can pick it up. I can touch it. I can knock on it. I can pound on it. Glad it didn't break. You know, I mean, that's substance. That's what faith is. It's something tangible. It is a tangible belief. It is a tangible understanding. It is a tangible thing that you can put your hands on, your life in, everything that you are in. It is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. See, when I have faith, I know that I will be able to do and overcome and go through whatever situation I'm in, not because of me, but because of my God. I've got a God of hope. And my faith is the substance of that hope. And it needs to be put into action. Now, here's something I want to talk about just momentarily. And we're going to get through to this. And because you're like, when's he getting to the real message? This is just the introduction. Don't worry about it, okay? We get confused about the word hope. Because in English, we use the word hope. I hope it don't rain tomorrow. And we all know that it's probably going to rain tomorrow. But we're hoping that it don't rain tomorrow, right? See, I'm hoping that it rains about 6 o'clock tomorrow. That way it doesn't interfere with anything we're doing. But that's beside the point, okay? That's a hope, right? You know, and so when we say, I hope that, my kids talk about, I hope the tooth fairy comes, you know, because sometimes he forgets to show up, you know, but that's beside the point, okay? I mean, she, whatever it is, forgets to show up, okay? You know, but, I mean, that hope, you hope for things. And when you say, I hope, there's like this connotation that it might not happen. That's in English. See, but if we go back to the original language of the Bible, we get there till we understand that hope was a certainty. It was something you could take to the bank. It wasn't, oh, I hope it may happen, it may not, but I really leaning towards that it does. No, it was saying, with certainty. And that's why it says in this translation, now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Because it is certain that it will take place. There is no doubt. Friends, I want to tell you something. What God has promised you, he will see it through. I don't have to worry about the day that I check out of here and I get up there on those pearly gates and I bow before my heavenly Father and him going, how do you spell Hamel again? I'm not really sure if I see that. Was that one M, two L's, or, yeah, I'm not sure about it. No! I know when I get to heaven, because I've been faithful to him, what he's called me to do, when I get there, I'm going to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. Come and receive your reward. I don't have no fear. Not because I'm perfect. Anybody knows me knows I ain't perfect. God bless them all. Let's go back to scripture, something that's important, amen? Psalm 39 and 7. We want to read Psalm 39 and 7. We'll bring it up for you here real quick. But now, Lord, what do I look for? My hope is in you. Just think about that for a moment. But now, Lord, what do I look for? What is it that I think I need? What is it that I'm going after? What am I striving for? What do I look for? My hope is in you. That needs to be the message of our life. Lord, I'm not looking for anything. I'm just looking for you. We're not wanting in anything. See, sometimes we worry about a problem and we talk about it to others. We love to run to people and talk about our problems, don't we? Yeah. And we have sleepless nights because we don't know how God is going to see us through. And we stay up all night worrying about it and struggling with it and wake up tired and exhausted because we're worried and struggling about the situation that we're in. And the things that we don't do is, we don't take it to God in prayer. Now, I know some of you sitting there go, oh, yes, I do. You don't know me. I take it to God in prayer and I still worry about it. Well, then you're a double-minded man. You're unstable in all your ways. Scripture says that you ought not to have anything that you ask for. Come on now. Isn't that what Scripture says? Look, if you take something to God, how do you think you can do a better job than God can? How ridiculous is it that you think, as a mere human being, that you can do a better job at taking care of your problems than God can? But now, Lord, what do I look for? My hope, my faith, the substance of what I believe in is in you. I'm not lacking anything. I'm not wanting anything. What I don't got, evidently I don't need right now. I just keep praying for it. Keep looking for it. Lord, I know you're coming. There's a song that we used to sing. It says, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. See, I'm not going to try to sing it for you. I'm just going to read it. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Think about that. My hope is built on nothing less. When your hope gets off of what you can do and what God can do, you might be able to see yourself through what you're going through by leaning on Him. See, that golden feeling that student talked about is what I got today because I know God's word don't lie. My God has got a plan and a purpose for me. He's got a plan and a purpose for you. And I can promise you, it ain't to sit in your house and mull over and wonder and cry and mull and whine and cry about what you ain't got, about what you need. No, that ain't what it is. His purpose also ain't for you to go out and try to make it happen. Because we know how that goes about, don't we? We get the gumption up like, I'm going to go make it happen. Yeah. Next thing you know, you got a whole other religion following you like Abraham because he had to go out and make it happen. Abraham, Abraham, Abraham. I got hope because all the patriarchs that are listed in Hebrews 11 were far from perfect. I've got hope. I've got hope that God can use somebody that's missed the mark, has gotten it wrong, has went out and tried to accomplish God's work in his own power and had to turn around and go, okay, Lord, that wasn't how you want it done. I'm trusting you now. I've got hope. Everything that was written for us. I've got hope. In fact, I want you to do me something. Do me a favor. Turn to your neighbor and tell him, I got hope in Jesus. Oh, come on now. I can't hear it. Tell him again, I got hope in Jesus. There you go. Make sure y'all are awake. Y'all look like y'all are sleeping. Look, now, I'm not naive. I know sometimes life is hard. You know how I know that? I'm living. I'm living. Life is hard at times. And I know that all things are recorded for us to read so that we can have hope in God. I want you to think about this for a minute. Think about the nation of Israel. Do you think maybe they felt a little overwhelmed and confused? I mean, just think about this. I mean, they were called out to go to the promised land. They finally left in the slavery of Egypt, and they're traveling towards a promised land. And they get to that big old river that they can't cross. And here comes the Egyptians behind them. They know now they're fixing to be killed. And there's no way to cross this river. Do you think that maybe they felt a little overwhelmed? A little confused? Like, what am I going to do now? Friends, everything was written for us. When they had no hope, they looked to the Lord. And he made a way. And they walked across on dry ground. What about financial situations? We talked about being overwhelmed, confused. We know that we can look to the Lord for to help us when we're overwhelmed and confused. What about finances? Some of us think that God don't really care about our finances. But he does. He does. One of the things I take greatest hope for when I read scripture, when I'm having a financial problem, I'm looking to God to help, is the fact that he sent Peter to go fishing. To pay the temple tax. He caught that fish. And he reached down that fish's mouth and pulled out the exact amount of money they needed for the temple tax. If God can provide money in a fish, he can certainly provide for me. I don't know what your situation is, whether you're overwhelmed, whether you're confused, whether you're having a financial problem, but God is able to give hope to you. Amen. There's story after story of promises. What about Joseph? Sold into slavery. How much worse can it get? Your own brothers sell you into slavery. You've been betrayed by your own family members. They've turned their back on you and sold you into slavery. And you're being taken off to a foreign land, and you're someplace where you don't know what to do, and you don't know how you're going to make it, and you just know that your life is over. Then all of a sudden, the God who you have your hope in puts you in charge of everything. And your brothers come crawling back to you. Gotta love it, right? Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. And we love it when he does it too, right? Think about that. No hope to being in charge of everything. Oh, it wasn't an easy trip getting there. In fact, there was times that he thought he was going to be okay and then got put back in prison again. Then he thought he was going to get out, and it didn't happen. But eventually, God fulfilled the destiny and the promises that he gave him. And all his visions and all his dreams that he had came to pass. Friends, that's what I want to share with you today. Maybe you're on this journey right now. Maybe things aren't going exactly how you planned, but they're never out of God's hands. Maybe you've started off on a good work and only had everything seem to kind of cave in. Maybe you've never even started because you just don't believe. This word was written that we can have hope. Hope for a future. Hope to know that God has something for us. God's promises are always true. God's promises are always true. What has he promised you? What has he told you? What has he laid on your heart? What is it that God has given you that you have forgotten about, or you've laid to the side as an impossibility? Friends, I want to tell you something this morning, that nothing is impossible for God. Nothing is impossible for God. Estranged family members will come home one day, amen? Finances that you need will be provided. If not, maybe once you go on a mission trip and never come back. Hallelujah. I don't know what God's got in store for you. But maybe he's snatching the rug out from underneath you to get you to move in a new direction. But whatever it is, you've got to trust him. His promises are true. Sometimes it won't appear to make any sense. I'm just telling you. There's times that God's ways just don't make no sense. In fact, Scripture tells us his ways are not our way, his thoughts are not our thoughts. You know, friends, I want to tell you something. There is no way, if I were God, in fact, somebody told me today, thank God you're not God. Yeah, okay, well, thank you. It's a good thing I'm not. But there's no way, if I were God, when I take my one and only begotten son, send him to earth to be born as a human, to live as a human, and give his life for the very people that persecute him. I just wouldn't have done that. I would have come up with some other plan, and it probably wouldn't be nearly as good, amen? Because I'm not God, thank God. I'm not God, amen? His ways sometimes don't make any sense. In fact, Romans 4:18 says, against all hope, Abraham in hope, that's almost contradictory, isn't it? Against all hope, when there is no hope, against everything you could possibly hope for, Abraham hoped. He believed. It says Abraham in hope believed and so became the father of many nations, just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. God could have gave him some children in his younger age. I don't know why he waited till he was so old to give him kids. But that was God's plan, not my plan. I don't know why God's holding back right now for you. I don't know why it seems like God hasn't really come through with the things that he's promised you. Or why does it seem like you feel like I've done everything I'm supposed to do. I've given everything I'm supposed to give. I have nothing else to give, nothing else to do, but yet it's still not happening. And I'm about to give up against all hope. Hope anyways. Like Abraham. It goes on to say in verse 19, without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was dead also, was also dead. She was dried up. The old woman was dried up. That womb was shriveled up. It was dead. He had no hope. But yet God promised him, you're going to be the father of many nations. God promised him that his offspring would be as numerous as the stars. And against all hope, laying there almost dead at 100 years old, his woman all dried up, can't have no more children, all of a sudden God pops through and does something miraculous. Verse 20 said, yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God. That's where we need to be. That's where we need to be, friends. We need to be there where we do not waver, where we don't give up, where we regard the promises of God as yes and amen. Verse 21, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he promised. Are you fully persuaded today? Do you believe? Do you believe that God's going to do what he said that he will do? Yes. Last scripture, I'm going to read it for you real quick. Psalm 43 and 5. Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Let me get the praise team up here. We're getting ready to close. Friends, I want to ask you today. If life has been hard, if it's been difficult, if you are unsure or have been unsure where God is taking you, maybe you've been scared. Maybe you just have been at a point in place where you felt like you knew that you knew that you knew, but now you're just not so sure. Maybe the enemy's kind of crept in with a little bit of doubt. Today, I want you to be strengthened by his word. I want you to know that you know that you know that he is God. And he is in charge. And he loves you. And he has promised to never leave you nor forsake you. He has promised to stand beside you. He has promised to not give up on you. He has promised that if you'll put your life in his hands and you'll be obedient to him, that he will see you through to the very end. Now, friends, I want to tell you, this isn't necessarily a feel-good sermon. I'm not one of these preachers that's going to tell you to come give your heart and life to God and everything's going to be honky-dory. Because I want to tell you something, sin is in this world. And as long as sin is in this world, God's promise that he gave to Adam and Eve that we would surely die is in effect until the day he returns. And I don't know what sickness may be on you or what trouble may be on you, but I know this, if we put our faith and our trust in God, he will see us through. Yeah, we may stay sick. We may be healed. We may lose our house. We may not have enough money to pay our bills. But the reality is this. We have a friend that'll never leave us. Never forsake us. And I want to tell you something. That puts a smile on my face. It puts a smile on my face no matter what goes on, because I have hope. I have hope. I have hope. We have a God of hope. And I want this morning for you to find that hope. Stand with me. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that you are a God of hope. And today, Lord, I just want you to just move in your power and your presence, Lord. And I want your spirit just to rise up with inside your people. Lord, the people that are here that have been struggling, Lord, the people that have been wondering where you are, today will know you're right there beside them. I ask you to move. Move mightily, Father. In Jesus' name. The altar's open. We come. Altar team, come. Whatever you need prayer for, we want to pray with you.